And so the guys were talking about having a professional circuit and professional this and that, but judging at that time was still done like a beauty contest, and a little more than that. I mean, you'd watch somebody surf, and on a scale of 1 to 10, you would decide if he was closest, who was closest to the curl, and did the most maneuvering, and this and that. So it was a lot of movements, purposeless movements on the wave to show that you could do this stuff. And I thought, well, the future of the sport would be to have purposeful movements. That is, if you had a course that required that you cut back here in order to get around this thing, and then you had to milk the wave and get up on the tip and then back off and come around this thing and do all that in order to make it, that would be pretty exciting. Does he make it? Does he not make it? Because even in diving, which is so beautiful, it's up to a judge. And that kills it. But pole vaulting, high jumping, the discus, running, it's clean. It's man against nature. And it's beautiful. So how could you do that in surfing? Well, the simplest way you could do it is time on a wave. And that would be a little boring for the customers, but nose riding had become something of significance and interest. In fact, we were all interested in nose riding. And I had a board that was specifically designed for better, improved nose riding. So I had my own rider in there, and he didn't do very well in it. The purpose of the contest was to promote my own little business, and then to promote the actuality of surfboard design, and to sell my board, which had a better nose riding design, I thought. So we held this contest. I invited 25 of the world's best surfers, best nose riders, and they all showed up. And the entry fee was $25, which was a lot of money these days. It was like $250. The prize was $1,500, I had 5 judges and 10 assistants, and each judge faced as a wave as the rider came along. The judge would note that he was or wasn't on the first 25% of the board, which I arbitrarily determined was the nose, and had painted with a bright colored paint. All the boards came in the night before. We put these black strips behind the 25% section, and then these yellow, red, different colored noses, whatever they wanted. And you could kind of see. You still couldn't see, and the guys still could cheat, but it was better than nothing. Two guys, Rusty Miller and Mike Doyle showed up with. Doyle had called up earlier and asked, how big a tail block can I have, do I have to have on this board? He said, what are you talking about? He says, do I need a 6-inch, an 8-inch tail? I said, I don't care how wide your tail block is, you can have it with you want, you know. Okay, thanks, click. So Doyle and Rusty showed up with 9-foot boards and at least another a good 4 feet of double T-bands coming out the back, a piece of wood sticking out the back, which made their 9-foot board 13 feet long. And so they wanted, and their noses were painted up for the first 25% of 13 feet. And they wanted to, Doyle got a little testy in a friendly way, you know. Come on, I called you, said da da da. And I didn't know what, you know, he said, these are the rules. And it's right at the beginning of the contest, and there's a lot of people with a lot at stake, with a lot of cool boards there. And he kind of kept insisting, and I said a little prayer. I said, what am I going to do? And at that point, a seagull flew over and pooped on Doyle's board, and I had a bad headache. And I said, you know what? This is my contest. I don't care what I said. Those things, you cut them off, you're out. You know, or you can ride if you want to ride, but not for money. All right. Rusty sawed his off, but he left his two bricks on the back. He had resin two red bricks on the back for counterbalance. That's how that contest came about. It was a terrific contest. There was controversy because I had not thrown out the high and the low of the five judges. Consequently, Mickey Munoz was nose riding, and he had his hand down here, and he's doing all this stuff. But he's not quite on the nose.
Oh, no.
Four of the judges could see that, but the judge that was... couldn't see it, that he was coming towards.
Thought he was on the nose.
Thought he was on the nose and gave him high scores. And when those scores were averaged, it gave him a pretty good score.
Yeah.
So he won the contest by 0.7 seconds over Mike Hansen. And about a year or 2 years later, I was going over the scores. And shit, I had to put the papers away. And I noticed this anomaly. And so I contacted Munoz and Hansen, and it's been kind of a problem for them ever since. Where Hansen has come and Melinda has had me write a note, write a letter explaining this, and how had it been that that would be the real winner. But it's like any kind of a sporting event. You know, the judge, the guy was out, the ball was in the tank, the ball hit the line and hit the line.
Controversy. And so you mentioned that this contest was put on, you know, to promote the surfboards and the brand. So would you say that contests today are very similar then in spirit when they back
no.
in 1965?
No, they have still maintained this judging 1-10 because the judges, they want to beat you. They don't get the very best surfer to judge either. Now, I was in a surf contest. I was in two surf contests, and Phil Edwards was the judge, and I got a first in one of them, and I got six in another one. That was fine, because Phil Edwards was the top of the heap. Phil and Mickey Doyle were the shining stars of the era, except for Bobby Patterson, who was the exemplar that brought Hawaiian surfing to California. And Bobby was a natural, swinging, cool guy that died too young. And that everybody would kind of get out of the water and watch, including Phil and Dora. Everybody watched Bobby. Bobby was nonchalant about everything. And just to see him sit and watch Bobby smoke a cigarette or do anything was a thing of beauty.
What was his last name again?
Bobby Patterson. They were the Patterson brothers, Raymond, Bobby, and Ronald. And they had come over here to work. And we're at the foundation of the manufacturing process. Bobby the glasser, Ronald the sander, and Mystic, horse better. And Raymond, a terrific, terrific ukulele player, and all good surfers, you know. Ronald was sanded for Hobie, tobacco, cigarettes. He'd have his sanding mask on with two holes and two cigarettes.
No way, really.
You know, they just jammed us with cigarettes and alcohol. I mean, all those old movies, the actors, they find nothing. They
right.
pull everything out and do all this stuff. Too bad.
Listening to the sea, initiate the ladder to the moving wall fraternity. Buy your gas. of a hot little hook.
You once said, if and when our government goes to hell, I'd just as soon be in Cabo. So do you live in Cabo now?
I would just as soon be in Cabo now.
Do you still have your place in
but
Cabo?
But I'm in a band here. And I'm in a partnership with a really good guy, and making surfboards. And
what's the name of your band?
Laguna Jazz Quartet. We've been at the Salt Creek Grill for the past 80 months. We have a terrific CD called Music from Another Room, written by our genius bassist, Jack Prather. That's my biggest problem right now, is I got to market that thing. I got to figure out how to market that. I need somebody to run with that and make that happen.
Gotcha. So how do you feel about Obama?
I told you, as a Baha'i, one of the things that we're to do as Baha'is is stay away from politics because it's partisan, it's separatists. This guy versus that. We've got too much of that in the world. We have the reds and the blues. We have all these counties, states, and countries. The world's all divided up with people pledging their allegiance to this and that, and it's a real mess. And we need to realize that we are one organism. Our first priority is maybe us, but we're part and parcel with the whoality of it. You know, that's a new word just popped in, the whoality. And stay focused on that and bringing into the consciousness the concept, which is like duh, but the concept of the oneness of mankind.
Oneness.
The oneness of mankind, the oneness of religion, that the basic, essential foundation of all religions is that
connection.
You have a God that's vastly exalted. We don't know what that's about, but that we are the Baha'i teachings are about, that we have a purpose. Our purpose is to know and love God. Or whatever God is, we keep projecting man or woman or things or people or big or humans and all that. I mean, each one of those is a problem to better understanding. So back down into the previous president versus the next president. No. So I'll tell you what knocked me out about Obama. This sucker's hell, he's a body surfer. I saw the picture on the internet. Did you see that picture?
Yeah, I have. Yeah, he lived in Hawaii.
He's going left at Sandy Beach. I've surfed Sandy Beach. It's a tough place. You don't even get a wave if you're not hip, if you're not in. So here's a black guy who's a popolo in Hawaii. You know, they've got all the prejudice. They got many layers of prejudice. He's there at the bottom rung, and he's living there, and he's playing basketball, and he's smart. He's that he could run the gauntlet and make it through the past the Clintons and past all those other people, and keep going. My God, what a musician, man. What a cat.
Yeah.
What a Charlie Parker.
Sure.
You know.
Yeah.
So bring on the next one. God bless him.
So what countries have you visited?
I have Puerto Rico, Costa Rica, Taiwan, mainland China, France, Spain, Portugal, Costa Rica, Mexico, Canada, and that's about it.
And what's your favorite?
Germany. Germany. Switzerland. Germany. I drove 500 kilometers on their freeways in a rented car, and I hit one shallow pothole, about a quarter of an inch deep, maybe 3-4 centimeters. That was the only impediment to the roadways. There were no signs. It was like rolling grass and cattle. If you wanted to eat, you kind of looked if there was a side street and go in there and to find a restaurant. There was no signs, eat here. No, you went in there and it was modest, it was family, it was lovely. God, it was lovely. And then the airport in Munich, and the museum, the science museum there. It was, to me, it was the center of the Western civilization. That's where the real Western civilization is. I've been in England too. And no fair, I mean, it was so cold when I was in England. This was springtime. I've been to Australia, New Zealand,
sure.
Bali. Yeah, I forget. You know.
And so, what scientists have you studied? Like, what inventors, scientists fascinated you growing up?
Fragments, and I'm not attracted to the scientist, the personality. I'm attracted to the revelations, what they come up with.
And what about like engineers? Like say if you had to pick an evening with a group of engineers or a group of surfers, who would you rather hang out with and feel more comfortable with? Or you're probably comfortable
well,
with both.
Yeah, jazz musicians.
That's who you're.
Because the thought process is that's what it's about, convolution. I was just watching Ken Burns' fabulous history of jazz. What a documentary. What a guy that guy is. What a documentarian or whatever he is. You know what I'm talking about? Ken Burns. Oh my God. And so the level of my thought process has been greatly enhanced by my exposure to and practice of music, and practice specifically of drumming, where you learn to do this with this hand. I can do whatever I want with one hand and do something else with another hand, and with this foot and that foot, so I can multitask and be listening and blend that with other players. And then, as in surfing, you see the waves come and you decide what changes and chances to take with the changes that are coming, which is a great, great teaching skill tool.
Intuition.
Surfing, watching them, and then blending as you get into it. And after a while, you've gotten into the cycle of it. You can't, intellectually, you can't say these waves are coming every so many times. Mm-hmm. Like that. You just know that. I'm going to kind of go over here, and sure enough, see, mm-hmm. You know.
Yes.
So I would take, the engineers are, if I could find a guy that was an engineer, surfing, musician, artist, but you know, these people, the true lover, Baha'u'llah puts this very good, he says, the true lover speaketh many a tongue. It's not specific to these different things, but I found from my experience at Boeing in the engineering group that guys I liked the most were not the engineers, but were the technicians. The engineers that come out of college have quite a lot of shtick. They got their engineering ring, their graduate ring, and they're regurgitators of principles. The real engineers are responsible for the structure of society, the roads, planes, and all
sure.
That stuff. And like at Boeing, you cannot have planes fly. You know, the main thing is that the plane gets there, all that kind of stuff, reliable. So these people are, yes, but don't you think? There's an awful lot of ass covering in professional worlds where each person who has achieved some kind of a professional status has his reputation on the line, and so he's covering it all the time. Consequently, I don't believe you quite get a clean shot from an AMA doctor, a certified dentist, and the engineers are all conservative, so that if something goes wrong, it's not going to reflect on them. So they are not my first choice to spend time with.
Okay. Oh, and favorite place to vacation out of all the countries that you visited? What, your favorite place?
It's too hard to say because things change. I don't want to, you know, I've been, I got amoebic dysentery. I don't want to get, there's countries I don't want, I'm afraid to go to certain countries. I just don't, I've been sick enough and hurt enough that National Geographic's good. There's no mosquitoes in the page they come by. They don't even show the mosquito. Tsetse flies, the little snakes. You know, the biggest causes of death are the snakes on the planet and malaria. To this day, it's had nothing to do with AIDS and heart.
So would you be able to say a certain country that maybe has, like, say, the kindness culture, if you will?
I am looking, for those of you who are listening, I am looking for a country to go to. Country where there's a king or queen that I could love and honor and be happy to pay the taxes for, that was not a militant, that was a benevolent, kindly, caring person, that was real royalty. As far as royalty based on birthright, no. Royalty is based on, call it astrology, it's based on when and where your station, the station where you come up and who they are. I don't know Nelson Mandela, but I would. That's the closest I've seen of anybody that I would. That. I have a friend from, a wonderful friend, Maka Susanna from an African country. Gorgeous smile, and she smiles and says, knocks you out, and she says they're all like that. We saw pictures of her family, and they all have this big smile, and they love their.
What country?
I don't know. Oh. I think it's Swaziland or the neighbor. And you know, I'd go there, except it's inland, and you got all those critters. What if I need to get my tooth fixed?
Favorite hobby.
I have made perhaps a mistake, maybe not. Einstein said, look, if you like to do something, you really like to do it, don't go into business doing it. That's like becoming a whore, you know. Do what you like to do for a hobby and then get a job or something and just do the job. But no, I went in the surfboard business because I like to make the boards, I like to talk to the people, I like to...
And surfing was your hobby.
Show them off, and surfing was my hobby, and music was my hobby, and drawing is my hobby, and I write, and I'm strong in any of those suits, I can do that, and I'm good to be good. So, I have no hobbies.
Your hobbies are your life.
Yeah.
Okay. Again, here we are with, we got spoon, fork, knife, hobby, all these divisions that people pride themselves on knowing all the names of these things and how they do this.
Classification. Right, and that you're again, I understand.
Gotcha.
Are you left-handed or right-handed?
I am right-handed, actually, but I've become quite ambidextrous from playing drums, and I work on it. Not lately, but I have from time to time really worked on use of my left hand for as much as I can to open up those other brain centers and to gain that way.
Favorite jazz band?
Favorite jazz band?
Man. Jazz band.
Too tough. Too tough.
What do you think
I
of
these? I could tell you some of them.
Well, I know you could.
Okay. Right.
What do you think of the invention of Facebook?
Facebook is a... I read someplace that if you wanted to hire somebody, you wouldn't go to Facebook to find out their qualifications. But if you wanted to fire somebody, you would go directly to Facebook. Now, I'm having some problems with relatives that are children that are on Facebook that are doing this thing, and they're, I've made some comments to them and back and their mother and all this stuff.
That maybe things that should be private that are now public on
Yeah, they're coming out, you know, and I can't
control.
I can't do Facebook, you know. I've got all kinds of people that I have forgotten their names, that I loved, that I liked, that I met, that I hung out with, and they want to be my friends. And I caved in. I just go, okay,
sure.
Yeah, confirm. So I've got, you know,
a lot of new friends.
700 new friends, right. And then if I open up Facebook, here's some friend talking about some other friend's thing, and then some innocuous thing, and they did the laundry, or... Oh, gosh, you know. And then there's all these little things to figure out. It's too much.
Do you have a favorite professional boogie boarder? Or is that too hard?
Yeah, this is all favoritism.
Okay.
I could be favorite guys, you know. But I can tell you along came Mike Stewart in his time. It was Ben Stevenson, and it was J.P. Patterson, and Pat Caldwell, and Carol Phillips, and there was a gal whose name I can't remember that was the first big wave Miami Bay boogie board rider. I think Phyllis. God, I'm sorry, I'd like to remember her name, you know.
Gotcha. So just to clarify, I understand that how basically throughout your whole life you read and studied other religions and cultures, but still to this day you consider your religion Bahia.
Say like Bahas.
Bahas.
And then
Bahas.
I.
Okay. And so.
So which is Baha? I.
Baha.
Bahai.
Bahai.
There you go. Just like Baja California. That is there's a couple of reasons for that. But that is the only religion I came across that encourages the Baha means light, I means follower of the light, of the glory, of the radiation. It's the only religion that encourages the Baha'is to go into all the churches and consort with all peoples of all races and types and go to their churches and read their things and read their writings. Independently investigate for yourself. Science and religion are in agreement. If something is proposed in science and religion don't, that means that science hasn't figured it out yet, or religion's degenerated to superstition. You know, how can it that Krishna, Buddha, Zoroaster, Muhammad, that all of these are like the sun coming progressively to nurture
the light.
The sun can't just suddenly come up and make everything work, you know, as it gradually comes up. The ones on the mountaintop see the sun first and all that stuff. And that all of these guys have extrapolated from here this information. There's no hocus pocus. But there are different stations, different mental capacities, spiritual capacities, and then there's the depravity that they come up in. So when it's darkest, then these things can come up. Like Baha'u'llah was in prison and in exile for 40 years, spent 3 months in a dungeon with chains down several stories and dung and, you know, prisoners, and kill one prisoner every day. And so from that comes this opening, see? So that, and that's written in today's language in his handwriting and his secretary's handwriting. These things are not studying 2,000, 5,000 year old things and elimination of rituals, elimination of the paid professional interpreter of God's word.
So
of course I have that, because I then am a Jew, I am a Hindu, I am a Buddhist, I am a Christian, I am a Muslim.
Gotcha. One.
And I'm an atheist, and I'm an agnostic.
So, but in...
Spoon, napkin, glass, out the window.
Gotcha.
Okay.
In your religion, and you speak of God and Jesus, so you believe in God and Jesus.
To say that I believe in God would cheapen the relationship.
it?
That to elevate Jesus to such a high station as a material being is nuts. That this blessed manifestation of the reality and the truth came about and prayed and fasted and took it to the limit and taught. So important. They wanted him to say that he was God. He would dodge it. He was going, you say this, and I am the son. He says, I'm son of man. And as to being the son of God, he says several places, at least several places, you're all sons of God. And that the station of becoming the son of God is when you wake up to this instead of being a slave to it. When you wake up to your potential and capabilities. So I see Jesus like that, the revelation for that day and age in Flatland, in a little part of there. He gave the teachings that enabled the city states to come about. Muhammad gave teachings that enabled nations to come about. Moses made it possible for warring tribes to quit raping five women for the one that they raped, or killing 10 of those guys for one. No, just one guy, one to one. Jesus said, yeah, that was good, but take another step further. Just give a little bit. And you know something? I see parents that send their kids to grammar school, elementary school, and they arm them with these teachings that are not made for a child. But that's savage stuff. You look at savage and brutal. You can't be going into that savage thing. But you could go in with Moses' teachings. The guy hits you, you hit him back, let him know it. But you don't take it further. And then later on, after the guy gets his butt kicked every which way from that, then he learns the progressive nature. Okay, that's good, but the better way to go is this way, and so forth. So the idea of progressive revelation is a very important idea, and that as to the manifestations of God, as to put one higher than the other, it's like to put one teacher higher than the other in school because they taught you a higher amount of math just because that's what you were ready for. But any of them could have taught you.
Right. So basically you would say that, say the Bible is not something that you put up at the top, but more a mixture of collaboration of everything.
Right. The Bible is a word that means a collection of. It's a collection of stories,
right,
of Jesus that was put together anywhere from 50 to 300 years after. Well, what do you know about something 300 years or 50 years after? From you got hearsay information, see? And it's a great book. It's something to know about. It's a study. But as to the holiness of a book, and the book with the gold leaf on it, and the guy's got this book, and he's going, and God, and all that.
Right.
Shtick, man. What the hell is shtick? Let's get down to us and hanging out and getting something done here, because I'm just running around back and forth and hassling and chasing that buck so we can pay those taxes, so we can keep the our nation versus the other nation. What about the world? What about all the people and all the books? Let's go from that.
But you and the night and the music bring out the beast in me.
We know the way to slow, the grapes were panned, and even though the soup du jour is canned, we'll have our table by.
And so what do you think about reincarnation? Steve?
Reincarnation is an interesting concept that's been around for a long time. And Abdul Baha, the son of Baha'u'llah, wrote, you should look it up and read these things. He wrote something very, very, I'm not going to be able to quote any of this, but let's just talk the reasoning, the logic of it. You can easily buy the reasoning that we are all interconnected here. This water I drink is going to go out. This air I'm breathing has molecules from all around here. I am just a collection of stardust. I'm borrowing stardust. The elements that are higher than carbon, or tin, down by carbon, have come from other bigger stars. Our little star doesn't have the power to. Okay? So here's all this interrelated stuff. And the empathy that we have, and we all are very moving and localized and connected like that. So, that we are basically one being in many bodies. Now. Also, now. Also, yesterday, last year, 5,000 years ago, one being. You're Jennifer, I can kind of recognize you with the glasses on. I might recognize you in your class, high school graduation class, or grammar school. There's something that's Jennifer, but it's all different foods, bone structures. Every seven years you got all new bones, all new flesh, saliva every week, month, something. You know. So, we are one being, and we were one being then, and we're one being now. Now, as to one particular spirit and soul, a particular thing that is separate from the rest of the things, you know, it's a frozen form, and it's always been a wave in the ocean breaking. Each wave approaching shore swells tall and then collapses. White topped I too now face the end of this guy's travel. And to my front, I was just sand and gravel. Disillusionment goodbye.
So what do you think is going to happen when you die?
What happens to your lap when you stand up? What happens to the hole in the donut when you eat the donut?
So,
this is me, this is you, this is another one of these ice cubes. It's more solid. It's not about you and I. It's not our creation. It's about God, vastly exalted and beyond definition, nevertheless, nearer than your own true self, the most evident of the evident and the most hidden of the hidden. Again, these are these teachings. You know? This, and I can't say this because that's materializing. This concept or that or God or each of these material things that we lay on become blinders, become veils so we don't quite see it anymore or see it clearly. So I've been awakening, going to sleep and awakening, going to sleep for 76 years. And I don't know what the hell happens when I disappear. I'm sound asleep. I fall asleep like this with a Nick's crank and chairs up. Next thing I'm riding up in a chairlift at Mammoth, three abreast. And there's a conversation going on between these guys. This is a fundamentalist on the left here. I guess he'd be on the right. And there's a scientist on the left. And this fundamentalist is going, 5,000 years, God created 7 days, yada, yada. The other guy's going, no, our carbon testing, dating times, dinosaurs. And I'm looking out there, and the skier's going down, and I'm thinking about how I'm going to hold my poles this time. I'm not going to make that same mistake. And we go up there, and then I wake up, and I'm on my couch, sound asleep. Totally fooled when I was in that dream. So I don't know that I'm not totally fooled right now, or that you even exist, any of that stuff. Great question, Jennifer.
Thank you. So how do you want to be remembered when you die?
I don't care.
You don't care?
And what I want to do is...
Not one particular contribution, nothing that really...
I am not. I am a
simple God
is,
man.
God is greater than every great one is God. God is great. And this is about creation's creator. It's about God's creation. And I'm just part of the... just funny.
Along for the ride.
I can tell you when I want to get done, you know. A whole lot of things I want to get done. I want to manifest the in a physical form these things that I've learned about flight and about what the Germans had developed and what I believe are the means for propulsion that we haven't touched on that are simple principles. I'm extremely excited about my recent revelation work has to do with magnetism and gravity, and I could talk about that to at length if you wanted. But
gotcha. And would you say that you pulled that from German studies?
Yeah, I mean, once I hear about something and it's interesting, my mother, who was the number one student in Detroit High School, and an alto sax piano player with a perfect ear and all that stuff, taught me. And when I come up with ideas, she'd say, "Tommy, look, if it was any good, somebody would already have invented it."
That's what your mom would say?
That's what my mom would say repeatedly.
Because I wondered how your parents cultivated your mind.
My dad, my mom was one of six sisters in Detroit. Wonderful woman, sweet and great and smart and all this stuff. But she was straight ahead. She was just straight ahead.
Very realistic, not a dreamer, if you will.
And big smile, big friendly smile, loving. My dad was a fifth grade graduate, high school dropout, salesman, smart as a whip. And anyhow, they got together, and they were married for 59 years until they had a lover's pact, and my dad shot my mom, and then shot my mom three places per their agreement, and then curled up next to her and shot himself at age 89. Instead of just going on and dragging this thing on and out. They were lovers, they were innovative. And they are still alive and very, very much alive in my world. They're not in that frozen phase anymore. They are liquid and called upon. They are in a different form, exactly. But those concepts which have been created.
Spirits.
What was the question?
We were talking about basically how your parents cultivate your mom.
But my mother would say this specific thing, and so for a long time I. But after a while I went.
So you would present ideas to her, basically.
Yeah, ideas would come up. And at some point it clicked that, no, this person doesn't get it. So I started developing things that nobody thought of. And then I realized from that, my God, in this brief time period, you know, they were going to close the patent office in 1850 when there was a proposal because everything had been invented.
How funny.
See? Well, I mean, 1850, 1950, that's only 100 years, 160, all that clone. Now they can clone sheep and maybe the cloning humans, and
right.
And it's all open, you know, it's all open.
Gotcha. So basically, you just looked beyond your parents and just pursued
I've had no choice in the matter. When you see something that's attractive, you are attracted.
A friend drawn of mine,
Duke Boyd, who's a good friend, that created the surfing clothing business, created Hang Ten.
Gotcha.
And Golden Breed, and was instrumental in the promotion of Lightning Bolt. Mm-hmm. Duke Boyd says, I'm attracted by distractions. And I'm distracted by attractions.
I like that. That's nice. Yeah. Any of your children, do they invent? Do you see?
Oh, God. Oh, my God. They're all so inventive. Mm. They're all so
lots
wonderful.
Of ideas.
So inventive. Each in their own.
In their own way. And do you encourage and cultivate? Obviously. Do you think marijuana should be legal?
That's a problem with a close relative that has gotten into legal marijuana and then is having real problems because lives in this environment here. And it's about traffic tickets, parking tickets, and following these laws. And Big Brother is there all the time. And this is a very innovative human being. But his
perception,
his or her clouds are in the clouds. So what marijuana is like I smoked marijuana for about 4 years off and on.
And during that time, did
Satchmo,
you?
And Satchmo smoked marijuana every day, a little bit of marijuana every day. And I am not at all regretful. I'm very glad that I did, but I lost some time. But it's like you're in the car. Of course, you guys nobody uses clutches anymore. It's a manual shift. But it's like having the clutch in and the motor's running really fast, but nothing's going anywhere. So the mind's really going off. Tea will do that. So while I smoke marijuana, I also smoke spinach. And I found that spinach did the same thing as marijuana does. But it wouldn't be cool to be smoking spinach. And spinach is not as powerful. And of course, all the sensationalists, youth wants sensational and wants it fast and bigger and quicker and all that. Yeah.
Stimulation.
And cocaine was about the leaf and about using it. And the Indians would measure the distances from village to village by how many leaves to eat to do that. And mostly we spent our time eating dog food. We're just we don't know foods. We don't know what's causing us. We don't know what causes growth. Why do we grow? Why do things grow? See, this is one of my big things I'm looking at lately. And it has primarily to do with the Earth's rotation through the magnetic field and the tremendous forces involved. Right here as we're sitting here, we're going 900 miles an hour through a magnetic field, and we're conductive or semiconductive, and depending on what we're taking in and all that stuff, all these phenomena are taking place that we haven't touched on yet, see? And so these people are, if you get into the illicit side, then you're just dealing with the dropouts and the money, and you get caught and sucked in, see? So my dad told me something very important, which he says, God damn it, he says, I don't want you to be a sap, Tommy. I said, what's a sap? He says, a sap is some guy that just goes for something and it sucks him in and it takes him.
And what was he thinking of?
He was thinking about alcohol, tobacco, and marijuana because they're good in sex. All these things, you tell the kid, don't do this, do that, and then he gets laid and he goes, don't do that.
Well, why not? Right.
But he doesn't know about all this other stuff, see?
But I understand.
And all this, so same with these other things, yeah. So marijuana, you start to go, wow, that's really great, and then you got all these ideas and they're talking and things are going right.
And your actions become habits and your habits become who you are.
And you become enslaved because the plants are running the plant, are in charge. Not these little things that are the gardeners. The plants are far more in charge and are running the show. Let's look at the birds. They cater to the plants. the bees, they cater to the plants. The plants suck them in and get them to do their job. They have their own life processes, and they live quietly, and they live in their environment with their friends, and there's love fields between them.
But very powerful.
Very powerful. So you start off a little bit of this, and the next thing you're selling it and growing it, and taking care of it.
And it's your life. It becomes your life.
It's your life, you know. You're
what do you
and
serve?
The beauty of a human being is that he or she is always a little out of balance. You're hungry, then you eat too much, then you're too full, then you're hungry, and then and you're breathing in. You just don't breathe in once and oh, it's over.
Right.
Yeah, it just goes on and on, pumping. And so pumping is a major part of, dissatisfaction is something that one learns to live with because that is the driving force. Satisfaction is null, you know, it's over. So as to legalizing it and as to who legalizes it, I, as the king, sharing the kingdom with my queen, Marcia, our family, I do not want that legalized for my family. Chartering, as to, what do you call it, some other organization to, here, I'll take care of that. The city, the state, no, the nation, no, some world thing, no. Bigger, as to giving governments ever more power, no.
No.
Family unit first, and family taking care of all the jobs, and families interrelating with each other, so as to provide preventive health care and critical health care and financial security and security against physical forms, everything from mold through vermins and pest through you saw the Mosquito Coast movie. Mosquito Coast, the guys. Blade Runner, what's the guy's name? President of the United States. U.S. American Graffiti. Major actor.
Tommy Lee Jones?
No. But Tommy Lee Jones is chasing him, and he's in that movie.
Okay.
Mosquito Coast, anyhow, the guy moves his family to some place. But finally these guys come in, a couple of guys with machine guns, and he's got to deal with me. Go ahead.
If you could invent something for the United States, what would it be?
I have been appointed Prime Minister to Empress Grace, who is the true ruler of the planet. Ruler as in a previous conversation here.
Gotcha.
And Grace cares. And as far as a government that publicly is flawed. There's just as a guy that studied math and equations and engineering, and you look at the equations and how these things are done. I'll tell you this about the Baha'i faith. It's not just a anything. It's a whole department store of. And a main part is that there is a universal house of justice at the top. National spiritual assemblies, local spiritual assemblies, thousands of them in every little town and hamlet and city in the world. And the voting is done by plurality. You're in a community, there's 20 people, 20 Baha'is. Comes election time once a year. You get together, quietly say some prayers. You read the qualifications for a member of the local spiritual assembly, which is devotion, well-trained mind, mature experience, these kind of things. And then on your piece of paper, you write down 9 names of the friends that you would like to be your local spiritual assembly. No campaigning, no electioneering, no nominating. You don't nominate. I'm sorry, this person. None of that. No swaying, even the faintest hint of that. And then these names come up, and those are the ones who voluntarily, without any pay, for 1 year, serve as your local spiritual assembly.
Like mentors, if you will.
And they are your rule makers for your community. And they are your parental body that you go to when you and your husband are having a problem, you're going to break up. And in strictest confidence, you tell your situation, and they do what they can to work it out. And they are who you go to when you have a problem with your neighbor and the fence and the pigs. They're your judge and jury and the whole thing. They are the parental body. I love this. Now, the only problem with it is that I have to do it. You have to do it. There's nobody going to take care of it but us.
And what about the human factor in it?
The human factor is in there, and it's got to... And so it's a long, slow deal, and there's all these human egos and verbosity and all this stuff that's... But it's coming along.
What's the best advice you were ever given?
Honey, it's the same thing as...
Too hard to answer.
You've got a banana split in front of you. You've got the spoon.
Good morning.
Well.
How are you?
Hi, I'm ready for a sandwich.
Do you want your sandwich with no lettuce? Is that what you're having?
Yes, I want the tomatoes, sweetheart.
Tomatoes.
I want some actual sourdough toast. Was that sourdough?
Sourdough toast. Extra tomatoes.
Hi, I'm Chuck Herpig with TomMorey.com. I'm here to tell you about the Waterscape, a beautiful collector board. I just wanted to show you Tom Morey's wonderful surfboard, the Waterscape, that he created back in, circa 73 or 74. This was the original one right here, one of the originals, and that board he made with a concave deck and wider rails, which was different than anything at the time, and the purpose for the wider rails was to give the surfers more control on the face of the wave and to have more water on the board. The concave deck gave the surfer better stability, a better footing, and allowed him to just really rip on the board. The board was very fast and very well received, but Tom, being what Tom is, he just had to go on and create his boogie boards and his fin systems and other things throughout his life. It's just been a constant state of creativity. So, but anyway, back in 2006, the Waterscape, which is what this board was called, because it just skated across the water, Tom created this new Waterscape here that is now a collector board. Just envisioned this board, bringing this board back, but then decided that he'd just make one and make this one, make it really special. So he got together with his friend Carl Ekstrom, a famous glasser in his time, surfboard glasser and finisher, and Carl finished this board beautiful red with blue lightning bolts, went back to the old lightning bolt era, and made this the same board. He put chine rails like he put on the boogie board in the back, which gave the board more speed and gave it when you're paddling or going down the line, but when you turn in, this engaged like a boogie board and allowed you to make sharp turns. It's a single fin, fast, terrific surfboard, and if you want more details on this board, go to TomMorey.com, www.TomMorey.com, and get all the the specifics for this board, because it is a collector and it is for sale and something you'd like to have in your quiver.
So down to samba, va 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 va. So down to samba, so down to samba, va.
Okay. I think sometimes what you learn most from your parent is what you learn in their absence. So I didn't grow up with my dad. He and my mom split up when I was probably six, maybe. And so I have a different perspective on him than I would, I have a different perspective on my dad than, say, my brothers do, because they were with him, 24/7, and I would only see him maybe once a year. So when I was young, our relationship was painful for me because there was so much absence and a fair amount of, feeling of being abandoned. So people would ask, oh, what was it like growing up with Tom Morey? I was like, don't really know. I didn't. But that did make the time that I spent with him more impacting on the things that I got from him. And my dad has always had this urgency, this kind of sense of urgency about imparting the ideas that he has. And so when I would see him, I remember times, we would be going somewhere and we would just sit down on the sidewalk, somewhere in Kona. And he would start talking to me, and I was maybe, 11, 12, about whatever the latest thing he was working on was. And so I got a real up-close view into his thinking process. And over the years, I've realized that, the ideas, and he and I, and my brother Matt, are wired very similarly. The ideas come real easily, and he's not real attached to them. So even though he seems really adamant about whatever it is that he's talking about, it changes. And I think really he's just got a real open channel from wherever the source of ideas is. And there's not a lot of filtering that keeps those ideas from coming in. And I relate to him in that way. So even now when I see him or when he calls me up, sometimes he'll just call me up to tell me about something that he's thinking about or working on. And there's no pretext of social conversation or how are you doing or, and I really appreciate that about him. And likewise, I can talk to him about things and know that I don't have to do much explaining, that he gets much more of the esoteric realms. I can talk to him about yoga and, my philosophical kind of thoughts. There's a couple of things that influenced me greatly. When I was probably 20, he came to visit me in Pasadena. I was going to Art Center. It was like my first year of art school, and I was 20 years old and my workspace was chaos. I had just stuff everywhere. And he said, one thing that's really important is you need to learn to keep your kit tight, meaning that you don't have a whole lot of stuff that you don't use or need, and that the things that you do have in your workspace, you have organized so that, you know where they are, and you don't have to break the creative thought process to go find your hammer or your X-Acto knife. You just know where they are. So that was huge, because as a working artist, I spent the last 33 plus years of my life as a working, exhibiting fine artist. It's important that you have a functional workspace, and that's something I didn't get from my mom. I got a lot of other things from her, but organization is not one of them. So I really got that from my dad, and I think that's a really important thing. The other thing I got, both my parents were self-employed. All of my growing up. My dad worked at Boeing for a little while, but for the most part, he and my mom kind of made up their livelihood as they went along.
So I saw that that was possible. I saw that you didn't have to plug into a 9-to-5 kind of existence, and that you could create your own life and your own livelihood. But what that required was a tremendous amount of self-discipline. And I think that, you know, growing up in an age where, you know, you went to college and you got a degree and you got a job and you did those things, and my dad was a drummer. And so becoming masterful at any skill, art like that requires, you know, what they talk about, the 10,000 hours of practice. He mastered that skill of drumming. And so that allowed him to learn how to learn and how to put in the time necessary to follow through on and pursue the things that he was interested in. And I know as a dancer, you know, it was like if I wanted to perform, I had to show up to rehearsals, I had to, you know, stretch, I had to practice. And as an artist, same thing, you know, I have to show up in my studio and I have to get myself to, you know, meet my deadlines on time, etc. I remember him talking early on. I worked on a swim fin project with him, which at some point is something that I want to display. And that's another conversation. But, gosh, you know, it was before 3D printing, and I think I was about 16, and he had this workshop in Kona, and Mike Stewart was working there at the same time. That's where Mike and I met. And I was sewing booties, neoprene booties, for the swim fin designs. And God, we just went through so many iterations of these things, and, you know, I would start sewing on something, and then you say, no, okay, we're going to do it this way, and I'm like, but you just told me to do this, and no, we're going to do it this way now. So we went through all these different variations, and there are dozens of swim fin designs that were never really finished. But at some point in that, he said, you know, you have to spend money in order to make money, and that's really true. You know, you have to be willing to invest your time and your energy, which is of value, as well as the materials to create something in order to, you know, make something. So I hear that in my voice sometimes. I mean, I hear that voice in my head sometimes, you know, encouraging me to, like, let go of the purse strings a little bit and do what's required to, you know, bring something into manifestation. Throughout some very difficult times in my relationship with him, and even today, because we are a water family, an oceanic family, we can always use the metaphor of the ocean to communicate. And I think that both my dad and I really see the ocean as a manifestation of God, or as a metaphor for God, really. I did a series of interviews with him probably a dozen or more years ago talking about that. I think having that common ground has been real helpful. One of my best memories of time spent with my dad was surfing at Hanalei. It was probably about 3 feet, maybe, you know, head up. And two of my brothers, Madison and Sol, were both visiting. And Marsha and my dad, Marsha was out on the boogie board, and the rest of us were surfing, and we surfed for hours, and it's just one of the sweetest memories that I have of my family interacting with each other. It was really great. You know, other memories that I have to this day are, you know, really the best times are my dad and I just sitting in a car talking. You know, we might be pulled up at the beach talking, and, you know, talking about all kinds of weird esoteric shit that a lot of people wouldn't understand and think we were both nuts. But that's the real sweetness, you know. I think that it'll be a while before my father's contributions to this world will be appreciated, because he's so far forward thinking. His ideas have always been way ahead of the curve. I remember when he was at doing R&D at Boeing back, gosh, when my brothers were really little, and they were living up in Bainbridge Island. He was talking about using graphite in the wings of the planes, and you know, I don't remember all of the specifics, but his ideas were way too out there, and the guys that he was working with were like, no, 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 this is how we do things. And even with surfboard design, you know, my dad's got some pretty far out ideas about how things could be done differently, but people tend to be pretty locked in, and the innovations tend to be micro changes in the manufacturing process or the materials that are used. When he is constantly rethinking things, you know, we'll be sitting having coffee somewhere, and you know, he's pouring cream into his coffee, and the pitcher's dripping, and he's like, you know, they should just, if they just did this, and he's constantly redesigning his world, constantly redesigning the way things function and the way things could function better.
My name is Sol Morey. I'm the son of Tom Morey, one of six children, and the oldest of four boys in his second marriage. Really, to share something about my dad is like a lifelong passion that I will always have, because he's always inspiring not just those in the surfing community or elsewhere, but to his children, he has kept inspiring. What could I share about him? Would be really a summation of his whole life in brevity, because so much of it could be gone into detail. But really, they say that an invention comes out of needs, necessity, necessitates an invention. And the boogie board came out of a really shore line break that would be so shallow as to chop off a fin. And the concept for him, because he's a concept person, was to take this phone that he had dragged along with him. He was playing drums here in the islands and so forth, and he carved it out, and he put the newspaper print on it, which maybe you've seen the original boogie board, and he called it the snake machine for the side, navel, ankle, knee, leg element that you use. As an acronym, he liked that name. It didn't go over so well later on, so he changed the name to boogie to incorporate kind of the movement, the undulating movement of the wave under this foam. It wasn't a board because it wasn't solid at this point. But the boogie name came about because of a transformation of popularizing the sound of it instead of a snake that might have not been as groovy. And that's kind of summing up how my dad would go about things. He would have an idea of making something better, coin a terminology that went with it, and if it didn't work, spin another name. And many things have stuck, even the swizzle that some people know about, which is a parabolic curve of the nose to rail on a surfboard, and we brought it in like a peanut, and what he coined the name swivel, swizzle. Of the things that I can say about myself, Sol, he says that was one of his greatest inventions for him at that time, because he was creating a name, a powerful name. I was born this summer, and it had to do with the sun, and so forth. He was into astrology at the same time, and he was really a doer. And he believed that whatever he could create, he could improve. And music was a part of that passion that he had. As a startup drummer with his own band and a lifeguard in Laguna Beach, he later went into the aeronautics of planes and what have you in Douglas Aircraft in California, therefore transforming a lot of what surfing is today. Creating a removable skeg system, the first kind of trash system, which is fart spelled backwards, and because of the polyurethane sulfur smell, and slip check, which is a spray that would go on the nose of the boards. Guys were nose riding their boards, and he created the first Tom Morey Invitational Surf Riding Contest that was a nose riding contest that had an actual money prize purse that no other competitions really had. There weren't really known riders to be making money at this, and you could see that somebody like the Cat, you'll know who that is if you know the Malibu riders, didn't see a need for this thing to explode or become better. No, surfing was really a way of life, keeping it to yourself. And you could say that from that time on, the surfing industry exploded because all these fabricators of surfboards were now able to produce and have a story behind it, which is where Malibu was the inspiration for much of that. And he was down there coming out of Douglas Aircraft. He was pretty white, but he'd bring new boards and he was trying new things. He was a hot surfer on the boards. But he needed to promote all of these great ideas he had. The fan topper, which is a corrugated hat that stuck together, flipped the other way. And so he, along with the surf check, the slip check, the fan topper, and what have you, the trap system, he had this contest to promote his other ideas. So an entrepreneur to the core is Tom Morey. And as a boogie boarder, which I would consider myself to be because I was in my mom's womb when she rode the very first boogie, and it was the Snake Machine at the time, right? So I'm telling you. And I only see him as a father, but he is kind of a surf father figure to many. And with good reason, because he is like riding his own wave. And we're watching him. He's got a better view. Maybe he's higher at the top. And we watch him how he waxes his board. Something that Herbie Fletcher, with the traction pads, really learned from him how to wax a board. And we're all artists in our own way. He was an artist, and he is an artist in his own way. He's continued to work with the computers and the technology to create better instruments of his design concepts in the way of CNC, drafting things out so that you can see from the dimensions what's going to work or not. And along with the background that he's had with finding the Baha'i faith at the time that he did, he created a numbering system, a numerical system, which is a 1 and a 2, which is like a V, and a 3, like three segments of a lightning bolt and so forth. But you can see that he was taking concepts from his belief systems and then trying to put them into practice too. Like, hey, there's a need for this. Maybe I should work on this. Of course, making money was always a part of something, so he'd have a job and the money would go into the next project. A lot of people say, well, why aren't you guys really rich behind some kind of desk in these corporate businesses? But that's not my dad. And he didn't really leave anything for us. He gave us our own wings, how to create our own jobs and how to sell ourselves and go forward with life, you know, creating more stoke. What I would say for a small fry like myself, behind his long coattails, I'm just trying to catch up with all these ideas that he's had and maybe bring some of them forth, but also working on what other angles or what other views I have. And maybe it's just the concept of being a surfer, and we're this surfing tribe, which he has shared with me. We have a consciousness that can really develop into a world swaying consciousness if we all work together. And surfing is becoming more popularized, if you will, because you learn to get along with what you have, as much of the guys down at the beach did. I think if you look at a person like Tom Morey, you'll see that he is a giver. And he's always working for something or somebody else to create a better idea. And he wants to hear your ideas so that he can give you a better idea of where to turn it. It's not about the money. It's about if you don't do it, you're going to keep that from the world. So you need to put it out there. Somebody else will take the flag or the fire and make it happen. But don't be afraid of letting people know your ideas and be willing to let them go so that they might actually become an idea. I think that we have a lot more to learn in this world, and it will have to do with just opening yourself up, being creative, and going forward with your ideas, because your ideas will create more stoke, more happiness in the world. And I love Tom Morey for getting more people wet than anybody else I know, and bringing people to the ocean and enjoying the ocean with some kind of fear, being respectful of it, and that we maybe should go there instead of going to the moon. Go to our ocean and create jobs, learning more about our world. Aloha from Maui, and love to y'all.
We have two wonderful musicians with us. Mr. Jeff Jorissen on the saxophone, and Jack Prater on vocals, bass, and compositions. And for our first number, the way we do this, what do you want to play? What do you want to play?
Up there above Malibu, and he was standing on the edge of his board. His board was like that. He was standing here. Catching it, and then after you caught it, then you turn over and put it there. And I woke up and I realized, Yeager's already done that. Yeager's done that, hasn't he? Then the thought came, no, Yeager hasn't thought of that. Nobody's thought of that. This is a new thought for you. A guy in my, with my particular temperament, I've been a drummer. I've been a jazz drummer. I grew up in Laguna listening to the radio that would come over from XCMO Tijuana, which was the only station that really played any music. And I'd hear the dance music and I learned all the tunes and did all that. But every once in a while there'd be these more advanced rhythms that would come. And then bebop came. And the music of Dizzy Gillespie and Charlie Parker and these guys. And that's another kind of twist and turns and opening. Everything is so, there's so much poor design, and a lot of, and some of it's getting called to account and being overridden. Cell phone's a great example of what's going on. Not very much money, you can buy this fabulous tool. So I'm there, yeah, I'm on the beach, but I got a college education. I've grown up in an artist colony. I've been a surfer and a surfboard maker, and I work in plastics and composite materials, and I'm very familiar with materials, and have become familiar with a particular material and have it in my garage that could be used, and have had it in my garage for months and have tried to make something else but failed from it. So I backed off and made the hot knife, with an electric carving knife and a hot iron, and a copy of the Honolulu Advertiser. I made the first boogie bar. I didn't know what to call it. I called it a snake machine for a while. Side, navel, arm, knee, and elbow. I tried that name out. That was not a very popular name. I was going to work that name in with a Morey and a Morey eel, because the materials are like eel. So I went in my closet, and I sat and I came up with the word. This is a language I came up with. No. The name Boogie revealed itself. It came to, you know, people talk about revelations. Well, I have revelations. We all have revelations.
One, two, three. Thank you.
dream of building a board that outperforms every surfboard and cannot break and cannot kill you?
Hey, you're great, Jennifer. These are great questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I did my research.
You sure did. As to using your name, which I cannot spell, and I'm afraid to try and pronounce because I don't want to mispronounce. Schmeer?
Mm-hmm. See?
Schmeer?
No. From Sauerbrücken.
From Sauerbrücken. What's that?
A German town.
Oh.
A couple hours from Paris.
Yeah.
Yeah. See?
Yeah.
It's catchy.
So, yeah, I wouldn't want to use that name on the board.
Well, if you change your mind.
If I change my mind, you'll be the first
to
know.
Call me. So, when you worked for Boeing, did you ever steal any classified information?
Did I ever steal?
Any classified information at Boeing?
Well, that's a, you know, I'm sorry, but this is the stupidest goddamn question I've ever heard.
It's trying to be funny.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it is funny.
Okay.
Of course not.
Okay.
You don't even tell your classification when you're classified. You don't say what you are.
I know, it was a joke.
Are you recording this?
Mm-hmm.